go through every day. He was so immense. His heart was so big and his faith was so big. And I will miss him every day. And I love you very much.
I won't try to get through this without crying. I come in with Desiree. Me and her have been friends for about 10 years or more. And I kind of got grafted in with Nathan because of Desiree. She called me one day. She had started going to Lee, and she was so excited. She was like, "Becky, listen, I met somebody. He's great." And I'm like, "Okay, what's his name?" Like, I mommed her. I'm like, "What's his name, Desiree?" And she's like, "Oh, his name's Nathan." "Nathan what? Nathan? I don't know what his last name is." I said, "So where are you meeting him at?" "Oh, we're going to meet at a coffee shop." I said, "Desiree, don't go nowhere by yourself like that." And then later I got to meet Nathan and see Nathan, and then we just kind of went from there. And when they got the house and they had Noah, and then they moved over beside Bill and Gail. And it's just like, no matter what we were doing, you know, we did it together. Nathan was with us, Noah was with us, and that's just how it was. And then the longer that it went on, well, I don't know if Dawn and Tammy are here, but it's just kind of like I know them now. I know Karen now. I know you now, just don't know your name. But it was just like they didn't keep you on the outside looking in. If you were with them, you were with the whole group of them. I remember one time my computer had crashed, and I had a research paper due. And I'm always really like trying to do the best that I can, get the best grade. And I called Nathan, and I was just flipping out. I'm like, "I've got a research paper due tomorrow morning. It's 10 pages long. I've been working on it for 2 months. It's gone, Nathan. It's gone. What am I gonna do?" And he says, "And," like, everybody knows Nathan's "and," his "and." What does that mean? And I'm like, and I need you to bring it back. The computer, there's something wrong with it. It won't turn on." He said, "Is it plugged in, Becky? Are you sure? Go back there and look if it's plugged in." And I said, "Of course it's plugged in, Nathan. Do I look like I'm blonde or something?" And he said, "Well, we'll look about that in a minute, but just go check, make sure." And he came around there and he checked, made sure it was on, and the computer had crashed. It was destroyed. And I thought, I was squalling. I'm thinking, I'm never getting that research paper back. My teachers are not going to understand. And Nathan's still sitting over there, and goodness sakes, just fix it. He got it all back. He got my research paper back, and I got it turned in time. And I was just thinking, that's the kind of person Nathan was. He was always there to help. He was always there to fix. He was always there to make sure everybody was okay. I was thinking also about Desiree and Nathan, how, because I came in with Desiree, and I got the stories from Desiree. I didn't really talk, you know, I didn't call Nathan that much. It was always me and Desiree calling one another. And when they were dating, and even after they got married, she would tell me they read books to one another. I'm like, "Who reads books to one another?" Nobody that I know. And all the times that Nathan was in the hospital and he was sick, it always seemed like y'all were embracing your time together. You know, not many people do that. You know, they don't. And I mean, I'm not sitting down and reading a book to nobody. It's just not what I do. But Nathan and Desiree did. They took that time and sat there and to read with one another, and that was their bonding time. And they made the most of the moments that count. They made the most of every day. They made that count. And there's very few people, there's very few couples, there's very few married people that could say that they make the most of those minutes that count the most. You know, she will never be able to forget the times that she got to sit and read with Nathan. You'll never forget that. I'll never forget the times that she called me to tell me about the times that she read with Nathan. I know they know the Harry Potter series or Star Trek. One time I told Nathan, I said Star Trek, Star Wars, it's all the same thing. And he said, "No, it is not, Becky." And then he gives you the detailed reason of what they're not exactly the same. I still can't tell you what the difference is, but I know they're not the same anymore. But I know that Nathan will leave an impression on all of our lives. Everybody that's here, and even the ones that couldn't make it today, I know he's left an impression on us. Mom, she couldn't get up here because she said she would cry. But I know that Nathan He helped us so much where we work at. We really didn't have the money to go and spend on an IT person to come in every time we called, to fix our cameras, to fix our computers, to network for us, things that we had no idea what even meant. Nathan's just like, okay, this is what you need, this is what you do. And we're like, so how do you do that? He's like, okay, it's fixed, just go. And I'm like, okay. And we would be able just to call him. It didn't matter, day or night, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, we were able to call him. And I remember one of the last times that I called him, it was right before they went on vacation to St. Augustine. I called Nathan and I said our internet was acting crazy, and I called him and he said, well, I'm leaving for vacation, but I can come if you need me. And I said, but ain't you leaving at like 4 a.m? He said, yeah, but I'll be there if you need me. And I said, but Nathan, you need sleep more than you need to come fix my computer. And he said, well, if you need me, I'll come. And I said, no, just stay there, I can wait. And then we see Noah. He looks just like Nathan. And even though Noah's small, he won't ever forget the stuff that Nathan did. He may not remember exact moments, but he'll remember. I'm sure he will.
You know, you were talking about a person that every one of us in this room have some relationship with. Back, these songs that Nathan listened to and selected were songs that described who he was and what his faith was. There's a song that Desiree wanted us to play called 10,000 Reasons. In that song it says, 10,000 reasons for my heart to find, a reason to praise him. And then it says, when my strength is over, and I have come to the point and place and time has come, then I will sing your praises 10,000 years. Listen to this song.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the the end draws near, and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then
very strong, caring person. You've heard people say that. I think willing worker describes Nathan. These flowers here that have been given by families and friends of his are not a total expression. Nathan had worked in our media department, and so Desiree said if somebody wants to donate to the in honor of him, they can do that. So there's others that have been doing that. And if you have done that today, or you put that somewhere in an envelope and you've left it somewhere for someone to give to the church, or if you put it on the table back there, make sure you put your name there so we can express to this family your gift, because we want you to know that. The first thing that Nathan did was decided that he was going to help on putting a roof on one of the buildings, one of our neighbors who had a trouble situation. I think he would have climbed up on the roof if they would have let him, but some of them said, no, so you work down here on the bottom. One of our members thought his name was Brian, so all through that time, Nathan never did correct him. And Bill, to this day, has called him Brian when he comes through the door, just as a joke, because he said, all that time I worked with you and you never even really let me know who you were. But he just didn't want to hurt anyone's feelings, so he just wanted to make sure, if he thinks I'm a Brian, I guess I'm a Brian. His heart was to do for others, his commitment level. He was caring, reached out. You heard a nephew mentioned reaching out to him. If you read anything on the website of the funeral home, you saw when somebody, I think maybe an uncle, was moving in, that he was there to care for them, help what he could do. You've heard all of these testimonies of that. He was an awesome father. That's how Desiree saw that. He was a family man, and every picture you saw describe that. I love the stories I've connected with this family over the time. They said that when they started out that he was a little rascal. He was more mischievous than his brother Tiger was. But somehow that role play changed, right? So that all of a sudden that role changed in that family. But you hear a mother and her expression. And Karen, I've heard you say, "My precious boy," and your love for him. And I love you. And I love you lots. I recognize that he had a bonding with a brother and a sister, family. But can I tell you that all of those who made some kind of connection with him, when you heard them get up here, it's kind of like they thought he was their family. That's how he had of drawing you in, being a part of who he was. Mark, you've shown a true attitude of a father. And I know that Mark was not his biological father, but he was indeed his father. And one time I heard that Nathan made this statement. He said, "You're my dad. You're here. You wanted me. And you've taught me how to be a man." What a testimony. This family has connected. Don and Tammy, every time calling me and saying, "Hey, this is what's going on." The love they've had. The care they've had. Those last couple days were testing times. And I read a scripture that seemed to pinpoint my thoughts about what was going on in this family. You know, there was another young man, lived about 33 and a half years. And it came time for him to leave. And those that were closest to him that you could call his brothers were actually like disciples. They were the ones who kindly questioned what was going to happen. And this is what Jesus said. Now before the feast of Passover, that was Jewish Thanksgiving Day, when Jesus knew that his hour had come, that he should depart from the world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world. He loved them to the end. He loved them to the end. Our Thanksgiving time has just come, and that Thanksgiving Day was approaching. In that room, if I could recreate for a moment for you the overwhelming love that was going on in that room. No pulling and tugging at each other, but yet expression of love. A mother who carried that child in her womb for those period of time, and then all of a sudden through those weak experiences of his early childhood and growing up as a teen, struggling through all that. I